Good evening and welcome to the Cape Elizabeth School Board Regular Business Meeting for Tuesday, April 11th, 2017. If you would please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item one, adjustments to the agenda. Are there any adjustments?
Did Susanna have an adjustment? I don't think so. Do I? Do I? For the resolution?
I think that's going to be in public.
Yeah, I think that's just going to be in public. Hey, thank you. Just check.
So item two, approval of school board minutes. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the school board minutes dated under 2, A, B, C, D, E, F, and G.
I second that.
Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item three, comments by student representatives. And we have Maggie.
Everyone is in a pretty good mood recently at school. Definitely has nothing to do with the weather. AP tests are coming up, so you can definitely tell that a lot of teachers are making sure that we're knowing most of the material before we go into the test. And stress is a little bit high, but not as high as normal, probably due to the weather. The science team is gearing up to go to nationals in a couple of weeks in Washington, D.C., which is also really exciting and kind of a new thing. I was part of a team who went on local access to film a high school quiz show, and we did pretty well, so tune in to local access in a few months to watch that. Aside from that, I was just mentioning that the student group is going to Cuba next week after many years of planning.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow. Very exciting. And yeah, that's about it.
Thank you. Go home and study.
Thank you. Yeah.
Safe travels.
Thank you.
Item four, comments from the public on agenda items. Is there anybody from the public that... And we can also comment on non-agenda items if necessary.
I'd like to comment on the resolution that a committee has brought to the school board.
Yeah. If you let us know your name.
Sure. I think I can remember that. My name is Maureen Clancy. I live at 11 Hemlock Hill Road, and I am the parent of a middle schooler and a high schooler currently. So I did write a few things down so I wouldn't forget what to say. I am also a member of the Cape Diversity Coalition. This is a group of Cape Elizabeth residents, school personnel, and most recently a student from our high school. We are looking to combine our efforts with the school's respect team, the high school's respect team, on this resolution. I believe this resolution is a first step for our district in stating our position, setting policy, training curriculum, and taking the proactive step of letting all of our families know that our schools are safe places. This resolution is an opportunity for our town and our school to join forces, to stand together against hate, bullying, and targeting, to declare our schools a safe haven, which the law provides us this opportunity. Our hope is that the school board will take this resolution, share with the school respect team to get their essential feedback, and vote to pass at the next possible opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Maureen.
Thanks, Mel.
Are there any other members of the public that wish to speak at this time? Okay. Moving on to item 5, communications. We have a report back from the New England Secondary School Consortium 2017 conference, which was March 27th through 28th of this year.
Hello, everyone. So the New England Secondary Schools Consortium is a regional partnership consisting of 5 member states, of which Maine is one. The others are Connecticut, New Hampshire, Vermont, and Rhode Island. And they are dedicated to 2 goals primarily. One is closing persistent achievement gaps, and the other is promoting greater educational equity and opportunity for all students. They've been in existence for some number of years, I'm not sure exactly, but since 2010, they have sponsored an annual conference called School Redesign in Action. It used to be High School Redesign in Action, but it has been so popular that they are now expanding into the middle schools. And in fact, by way of example, in 2010, there were about 300 people who attended, and this year there were over 1,200 people who attended, including 9 people from Cape Elizabeth. So attending this year were Susanna, for the school board, and myself, John Holdridge, our volunteer and ELO coordinator, Eamon Keenan, high school guidance counselor, and then 4 teachers, 1 each from science, social studies, math, and ELA. I'll let the 2 people behind me introduce themselves when they come up. But the other 2 teachers were Isoon Simpson and Joel Schroeder. Thank you. Yes. So this year's conference consisted of 2 plenary sessions and then 5 breakout sessions. And we get this a brochure that provides detailed descriptions of what we'll be learning in each of the sessions. And we learned the hard way, some of us, that you have to get to the breakout session early sometimes if you want to get a seat, because they will shut the doors as sessions fill up and people vote with their feet. But most of the breakout sessions are offered by member schools, which is really exciting. It's just a great way to hear what's going on around the region in education and to benefit from both the, the ideas that they've had and maybe some of the things that haven't gone particularly well. People are very honest in these sessions. And the schools are public, they're private, they're charter, they're rural, suburban, urban, just they run the gamut. And it is some of the best professional development that I have ever done. And I always come away with some ideas that I want to try out, either back when I was teaching in the classroom or now as an administrator. So as I mentioned, 5 sessions. The 3 that I found most helpful, most interesting, one was entitled The Gradebook Whisperer. And this is a school in Connecticut that is using PowerSchool to report proficiency to standards. And since it's our hope and intent to report proficiency to standards using PowerSchool, I got a lot out of that particular session. Another one that was helpful was separating academic performance and habits of work, which is something that the Proficiency-Based Education Committee has been talking a lot about. And this was a school that had started out with a rubric very similar to the one that we're proposing and had pretty quickly figured out that there's a lot to assessing and reporting habits of work. And so they pared their rubric down significantly and gave us other ideas that those of us who attended this workshop brought to the PBE committee. And it informed a recommendation that we made that we brought to the high school staff, and they're at the last staff meeting, they processed that recommendation, and you'll be hearing more about that down the road. But again, that was an example of something that was incredibly helpful to us, very timely. And then the last one that I found really helpful was called Policy for Practitioners, and that was one sponsored by Great Schools Partnership, which I should mention is the lead coordinator of the conference. Since the policy committee is considering its graduation policy right now, that too was very timely. So So great experience, and our, you know, once again, thank you for supporting professional development. I just think it really pays off for the district. So now, Courtney Farrell and Kevin St. Jar are going to talk about their experience.
I'm Courtney Farrell. I'm a math teacher at the high school. It's my 15th year at the high school. One of the best parts was the drive down with Susanna driving the Ford Flex, and we have a lot of private jokes for the rest of our lives from that ride. So part of it is actually the valuable time to spend with your colleagues and to meet meet school board members and work with administrators. Usually we don't get out much. A hard part is being out of my classroom for 2 days. And I think, and Kathy also said it's a way to get energized and hear about new things. And what was nice about it, which you mentioned, it is all teachers and administrators at schools sharing what they do that's working in their schools, which is, I really appreciate they're in the schools doing it. It's not someone who's out of school coming back to tell you something that they did before or something. So that was very helpful. I'll just tell you about the one workshop that I still am thinking about every single day since I've been there, which was a math teacher, a veteran math teacher, a woman from Vermont, I believe, who, it was just about open-ended math questions. So she had half the class, or half the room, she gave us a problem, which was a volume of a prism, and it was just labeled 4 by 3 by 10, what's the volume, and it was just one answer, and half that class was done in 2 seconds. The whole other half of the room had a different prompt, which was an open question, is can you find 3 prisms that all have the same volume, and then you could make it harder by saying, could you find a rectangular prism and a cylinder that both had the same volume? So there was more than one answer. It was engaged the students, that people were talking, they had to work, we were all working together in groups, and the other people, no one even talked in the other half of the room, they just said the answer was 50 or whatever it was. So I've been thinking about that on all the assessments I give. Do I give, and it doesn't have to be all open-ended, but are there some that are more engaging, or are you not just giving the same old math questions that you always give? So that's the one I've been thinking about. The other one that was particular in math was about scoring. That's one Kathy went to with me, and we're actually already doing a lot of what that already was about, but it was nice to see some examples of other teachers. That's what I really value, is seeing how else people are doing it. Can we garner some of their ideas and use it with ours too? So I think the only thing I would say was missing is we haven't had the follow-up. I've shared with my department what I learned, but I haven't really checked in with. I did happen to see Joel Schroeder in the hallway today, and he mentioned that he really liked the session on the habits of work as well, but I didn't even know he went to one, you know, so that was the one thing I would say that we haven't done yet, but I hope we will. So, and here's Kevin.
Hi, I'm Kevin St. Jar, I'm a social studies teacher at the high school. I don't have too much to add, except whenever school districts embark on these different initiatives, you always run the risk of reinventing the wheel. And why Hartford proved to be especially valuable is we got to hear from people who had tried one wheel or another. And I'm also on the PBE committee, and we were in the midst of creating, you know, a rubric, and we came back with a rubric, and this other school had implemented or attempted to implement a much larger rubric, and it proved to be almost unusable. So we had the benefit of learning from their trial and their adjustment. The other thing that's so valuable at these types of events is teaching's a lonely job. You're surrounded by people all the time, but people who aren't in the classroom don't really understand how little time you actually spend with other teachers. At Cape High School, I find we're very lucky. There's built-in time, and I work in a great department, and we spend a lot of time, or more time than most schools, I think, together. But to get down there, some of the best parts of the training was when the presenters stopped and let us at a table with educators from across the country sort of share our thoughts and experiences. So thank you for sending us.
Thank you for sharing that feedback with us.
May I add a little bit? It was truly my honor to be able to be there for the 2 days with everyone and meet new people, make new friends, and definitely the car ride down and back was a lot of fun and interesting. But you know, I went with full support of Elizabeth and Howard, and I feel so grateful that they value that it's equally important to keep school board members abreast of all the changes and evolutions and, you know, redesigning directions that are out there, that are possible for our own district, to stay on top of the news of what we're here for. So I'm very grateful for this experience, and I believe it's invaluable for other school board members next year to go to, one or two or however we can do it. But it's a priceless experience. And also, it's really, really special because this opportunity doesn't happen hardly ever to spend time with teachers and administrators in these settings and in downtime or in travel. It's really a unusual opportunity that just reaffirms why I'm so happy to be on the school board and doing what I'm doing, and knowing that we're all working towards the same goals, and that's been priceless. And I've thought about that a lot since that trip, how grateful I am for that experience. And overall, you know, the conferences. Really remarkable because it is a combination of private, public, charter schools from you know, the New England area, and it just underscores that no one way is the right way, that really we have to all work together and draw from the best, and if we think that one way is the right way, we're really limiting ourselves, so it's a good lesson. And just in terms of some of the talks that I went to, The two that stood out for me. Two were similar. They're similar. They were personalized learning with student voice and choice, and being an adult ally. These are two separate talks, but they were both leaning in the direction of bringing students to the table of decision making and policy making, and even. Courses. One program has a system where their student leaders that are self-nominated from their classes will have a student day of learning that's all driven and directed by the students, and they work with administration during the semester leading up to that day. And build a whole day around what the students wish to focus on, you know, academically. And then they do that twice a year, and they all praised and raved how thorough everybody was, and everybody rises to the occasion of being a leader when they choose to be. So I was really, really happy to see a strong emphasis on empowering student voice, and also the concept of being an ally to students, or to student voice, and that as much as sometimes we want to be the ally of the youth, it also requires some education. That, you know, adults need to learn how to listen to the students, and students need to learn how to talk to the adults so that, again, we can work together in the direction of a common goal. And then lastly, another one that totally struck me was around the concept of a wingman program. So there's a school in, I believe, Fairfield, Connecticut, that has started an initiative now that's 2 years at their school that was created by a father who lost his son at Sandy Hook, and his initiative is rather simple. It's just about building, supporting a network of students who demonstrate and go beyond, above and beyond, to show kindness and support of one another, and it's become the theme of almost all their academic curriculum. And I heard directly from students at that school and how powerful it is for them to realize that sometimes it's just as simple as being caring and kind and looking out for everybody else and doing more than what's asked of you. So thank you very much, and I hope other people go next year. And thank you to the teachers and administrators for being who you are.
John?
Just want to add that it's really nice to see some really concrete impacts from our new, more in strengthened commitment to professional development. I mean, what they're talking about with the rubric saved us hours and hours and hours, it looks like, of which is great. I mean, not all the results are going to be that concrete, but you will get those. They'll be intermittent, but it's nice to see the payoff right away. And you can learn from people who are doing it, and we need to be out there and mix from and take from the best ideas that people are actually doing. So it's great that you. And it's nice to see a payoff of our commitment. That's what's going to help make our education better.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Yeah. Moving on to item 5B, Superintendent's Report. The floor is yours.
Thank you. I wanted to announce two resignations that have come in recently. One of them is from our middle school nurse, Linda Chow. She is, and her husband and family are returning to Texas. That's their home state. And we're going to really miss her. She's been an outstanding member of the faculty. She'll be leaving at the end of the school year, as well as another really admired teacher, a second grade teacher by the name of Linda, Sigmund. She is I think also in the process of a relocation. And so two important losses. I know the principals have posted vacancies, at least I know for the nurse, and I think also Kelly's preparing for the second grade opening as well. But just wanted to acknowledge their years of contribution to the district and wish them both well in the future. As you all know, we received very good news about the health insurance rates. We initially had budgeted for 8%. We lowered that to 6% and found out last week that, in fact, they've been set at 1.878%. In round numbers, I think that's somewhere around $100,000 in reducing our budget, which is a very big deal, and we're happy about that. I think it should be noted that that's not just good luck. I mean, I think that our employees deserve credit for a lot of credit for this. I mean, people who are careful and safe at work, and people who work at being healthy and getting exercise and taking care of themselves, as a group, they are healthier. And a large part of our rate is driven by experience of our employees. And again, our rates are quite low. And I just think that's important to thank our employees for doing what they can to be healthy, and that the secondary benefit of that is that it helps with our rates. I wanted to mention that the Maine Department of Education put out an invitation for what's called the Screensavers Challenge, and it was put on as a subgroup called the Maine Learning Technology Initiative, MLTI is referred to, MLT, I think. And we're looking for student artwork to, I guess, be, it could be used on screensavers. And about two dozen student artwork throughout the entire state were picked, students' artwork. And believe it or not, one of them was from a student who was a first grader at Pond Cove. I mean, I think she was the only student who was in elementary school. And her name is Zabina Zimmerman. And that's a big deal. I mean, I just want to congratulate her and her family and her art teacher and teachers. But I mean, it was really sweet to see this first grader being in the thick of it as being the best artwork out there. So congratulations to Zabina. One thing that caught my attention this week that I wanted to pass on to you is that Andrea in our office does the detail work around what's called the April 1 enrollment numbers. So we plug those in every year, and it's an important bit of information. And Andrea noted that this year on the general form that there are 41 students that reside in Cape Elizabeth that have enrolled this year, that are enrolled at Wainfleet School. That's a very large growth. We don't know what to make of that. Andrew said that there have been years when there are 8 students, maybe sometimes as many as 20, but now it's 41. And I certainly have a great deal of respect for Wainfleet School and good for them, and I really mean that. I do wish, though, that I could know what drove those decisions. I mean, for some families, as we know, private schooling is just what they believe in. That's what they're used to, and again, good for them. But what I'd like to know is, are there impressions that people have that if we could respond to those might help be sure that their information or their facts or their feelings are accurate. I just wanted you to see this as a sizable jump in enrollments and for whatever reasons families choosing a private school. I also wanted to mention to you that on another note that I met today with Ellen Jordan, who is the director for CEEF, and she brought for me copies of the grants that have been received this spring. And not very many, but all 4 of them are quite exciting. And the CEEF board will be meeting with teachers that have submitted and administrators who have submitted these proposals, I think right after the holiday break. And then their board will meet the following night and actually vote on these. So I'm not saying that they're all approved, but this is the list that came in. And at least one of these proposals, if it does receive their support, then I will be bringing it to you in May for your consideration. Mm-hmm. Just wanted you to have this list. That's all I have to say.
Hmm. Thank you, Helen. Mm-hmm. Moving on to new business. Item 6A, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we appoint Howard Coulter as interim superintendent for Cape Elizabeth Schools for the 2017-2018 school year.
Second.
Discussion?
I just want to say, Howard, thank you so much for agreeing to stay on.
Oh, it's
wish it could be for a longer term, but we'll take you for as long as we can get you.
Thank you. I'm really looking forward to it, and it's an absolute pleasure working with you and for you.
I would second that. Thank you so much. Your warmth, humor, and wisdom have served us so well this year, and I look forward to another year with you at the helm.
Thanks, Kathleen. Appreciate it.
I also want to thank you, Howard, so much, and just say that I have learned so much as a school board member in this 1 year, I feel, than the first 3 years combined, so I'm very grateful for that.
It's a treat.
Yeah, and I'm going back to you assuring us that only 1 year is what you were willing to do. So I think we're taking this as a school community. It's a huge compliment that you're willing to stay longer. So
do.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
I have very little to add to just say I'm delighted. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Yeah, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
And as well, I would just like to offer my gratitude for your willingness to be here to do the work. I've learned through you how very challenging this job is, and I have tremendous respect and appreciation. So thank you.
Thank you, Heather.
So I'll just add that a lot of times what I hear from other districts and other people is that when an interim superintendent comes in, that it's just a placeholder, someone to kind of keep the ship off the rocks. And it felt like a very lowering of expectations kind of discussion. And what I would say is that hearing from teachers and administrators, parents and board members, is that you have gone so far above and beyond just keeping us off the rocks. And we are grateful to you, and thank you so much.
Thank you all. I just would say, in all seriousness, it is such a treat to work with this board. I think you're an exceptional group, and you are so well-intended, and you're so open-minded and positive. It's just a treat working with you. It's a treat being here working with these teachers and administrators. I honestly wouldn't be doing it if I wasn't enjoying it, and I'm really enjoying it. So thank you all.
Awesome. Thank you.
We should also offer gratitude to Nancy.
Yes.
I know.
Yes. Thank you so much, dear wife.
Nancy Coulter, we thank you.
We should send her flowers.
Patience.
Chocolate.
She has patience and perseverance. All those in favor? Thank you. Moving on to item 6B. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the superintendent's nomination of Kathy Stankard as the new director of teaching and learning for 2017-2018.
Second.
May I speak to this?
Please.
So I would hope that it's clear. I mean, I think the motion's perfect, but I think that what we're trying to do is for somebody coming into a new administrative job that they have a 2-year employment. So the motion's fine for next year, but I hope it's clear that the idea is that she would be offered a job through June 30th of 2019, and after that, it's an annual appointment. The logic behind it is to give somebody coming in a chance to have some stability and get into their job and have the confidence that they can go through a rough patch and not be worried about, well, you know, how's this working out with my reputation in my job. You're steady ahead, you've got 2 years, get into it, and then, you know, we'll go from there looking at evaluations and decide about extensions. But I want to be clear about that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Do we need to amend?
No, I don't. I think that it's in the minutes, and I think the motion is fine. I mean, it's just that it's just that the contract is meant to be a 2-year contract, but this is just saying that for next year she's got the job, and that's great. I mean, I'm fine with it.
Works for me. Does that work for you?
Further discussion?
I also want to say thank you to Kathy. I'm very grateful that that we've met and that you're now no longer an interim and permanent, and looking forward to another solid year with you on board.
And I would just add that having worked with Kathy in a previous life, I'm delighted she's landed in my hometown now. That's awesome. And we need someone with her skillful awareness of all that's in play right now in our schools and our ability to listen and help things take shape, because it's a daunting task what the Director of Teaching and Learning is being asked to do on behalf of all the new state regulations and places where we believe we need to be making growth. So thank you for your willingness to do that for us. Thank you.
Heather?
I too would like to thank you for being here. One of the things that I have realized over the past year working with you and being in meetings and having conversations with teachers is the mutual respect that has grown over this year, yours towards the teachers and the teachers towards you and your role. And I think the progress that can be made through that is quite exciting. So thank you for taking the time to listen, to be there for them, and to guide this process that's quite challenging.
I too would like to thank you because it takes a relationship builder and someone with great knowledge and skill to do this work, and we are grateful to you. Thank you. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6C, there need not be a motion.
Okay, jumping right in to IJOC, the volunteer policy. I would just like to share with the board that we had the privilege of having John Holdridge approach us about wanting to delve into policy. As he is in his first year, full year in this position, and some questions had arisen, and it really helps someone who's out front of this to have policy behind him. So it took a couple of meetings of talking through various issues. We had some parents that joined us in conversation as well. And when it all boiled down, our original policy was pretty darn close with just a few tweaks you'll see in front of you that are highlighted. I want to bring to your attention tonight in case you have any further comments for us from just the first read. And one is, he was really struggling with the idea of the background checks and referencing that have been sort of an expectation of all volunteers within the Cape Elizabeth schools. And after a lot of conversation about options, it was proposed and the policy committee accepted that background checks will be performed for all prospective volunteers plus community volunteers, meaning those folks who come to us from outside the school family would also provide two references. Our feeling was that internal volunteers already have a relationship with the schools through their children's teacher and principal and so forth. But folks coming into our community with super good intentions and would like to contribute to the schools, we would just ask that they also provide a couple of references that he would then check out on our behalf. So that was where we landed with that. We also talked about how some volunteer assignments can be pretty meaty, and teachers find this to be so valuable, but we'd like our principals to be very aware of any regular school volunteer assignments so that anyone who's coming in kind of a regular way and fulfilling an important role in a classroom, that has been vetted by our principals, and there's a comfort level there that this is appropriate use of volunteer. So that was added. One other question that had come up was, certainly we expect all our volunteers to be supervised and directed by authorized school staff. There was a conversation, particularly at the elementary level, about whether that immediate supervision met constant visual supervision, which sounds terrific, and we all strongly endorse, but there are times when it's really helpful if a volunteer could just step outside the door and work with someone in the hallway so it wasn't as distracting to the rest of the class, or perhaps take a small group to the knuckle and be in a commonly supervised area. No one's behind closed doors, but we decided to remove the word immediate and just imply that supervision is inherent on the teacher to find an appropriate comfort level depending on the age of the children and so forth and the roles that we're asking them to play. So immediate is stricken in the proposed language so that it can be based on more of an appropriate supervisory relationship. And finally, we added, just because it can be so exciting to be a volunteer and in and exuberant about what's going on, that we really do ask that our individual volunteers refrain from taking or posting photographs or video of students, and we'd like to add using personal devices while serving in a volunteer capacity. Mm-hmm. There could be times when a teacher might have a field trip and hand a volunteer a camera and say, get our class picture here in front of Town Hall or whatever. But this is really to imply use of personal devices around our students has no place in a volunteer relationship, and certainly posting of that material gets in the way of other policies we have about parents giving explicit approval before kids can be featured on social media. So with the help of our teachers, and John said he would be willing to help with sort of orientation to this kind of expectation, that would be a part of regular policy review in the fall, and in fact, a heads up about this particular part of this policy would be given right after the break, before all the spring activities get started. So that's where we landed. Happy to take back any other comments or questions before we vote next month.
I do have a quick question around the reference checks on volunteers for outside. I wholeheartedly support. I'm wondering if there's been discussion about whether that is retroactive for those volunteers from outside who are currently serving, or is that moving forward?
Good question. Did we talk about that, Heather and Kim? Because we talked about the background check being a one-time thing that happens.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think the reference checks have been on the books, because I'm not sure, is this added or is this language that was there and it's highlighted as being, let's see, how may see what we, yeah, right now it says reference and background checks will be performed for all perspectives. So I think that's the basis we're moving forward.
We're moving forward.
So it would simply stop doing references on parent volunteers.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But
the getting of the two reference, to submit two reference checks.
Right. And I believe that's,
on the background.
I will double check with him, but right now reference checks are currently being performed on all. So it wouldn't be new practice. We would just be pulling back instead of asserting forward. Do you see what I'm saying? Right now, references are required of our community volunteers and our parents. That's the way I read this.
So I read it because
That's not in practice?
No.
No.
As this reads now, the revisions are italicized and underlined with a highlight. That's new.
Oh, I'm sorry.
From what I'm reading.
Pardon me, because I was reading the striking above.
Oh, right.
You see where it was stricken? Reference,
right,
and background checks will be performed for all prospective volunteers. I will double check with John and answer that next time.
Okay.
Thanks.
So, Barbara, I had a couple of questions, but I'll let you finish writing.
I'm good.
So there were a couple questions. Was there discussion around how you would define the regular volunteer?
We did, and we tried to jump in any time, ladies, but we tried to be definitive about that, and it gets away a little. So our understanding was someone would have a regular weekly, biweekly relationship where they're coming in and assisting in the classroom versus your willingness to go on a field trip in 2 weeks. So the regular nature being a standing appointment. Okay, that was sort of how that was defined, if I recall that conversation. Okay.
Thank you. And another question I had was, if I recall correctly, John Holdridge had submitted a list of recommendations, and one of those had been a possibility of running background checks again after 5 years to kind of keep updated with the background checks. Did that not go anywhere?
We talked a lot about background checks and what they actually show us, and the limitation to them is pretty significant. We don't pull in a lot from it, considering the cost and what you're going forward and so forth. He was comfortable with a single background check, and then perhaps it would be the referencing that would be updated or something for community members or so forth, but. The recommendations he brought us, because I expected this to be much more lengthy and involved too, given what he originally brought us, but he was just sort of pulling where different places are, and he found, in fact, practice in Southern Maine is lighter than where we've landed. So it wasn't that he felt compelled to say we need to do this more strictly. He just wanted us aware of some of the other things out there. Am I remembering that right, Howard?
Thank you. I'm measuring in. I also think that the feeling was that are we really going to remember to check every 5 years? I mean, it's a possibility that we might drop the ball. If we're going to do something, we'll be sure that we actually are going to do it. Another feeling was that something terrible could happen between now and 5 years out. Mm-hmm. We don't need to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's kind of an arbitrary date.
Mm-hmm.
Another was that the kind of things that often would get somebody in a position where we would wonder if they really ought to be around children is far from a secret. I mean, these are things that have become quite public. And so between the schools and the community and the police department, the kind of things that we all think about that would concern us are things that we will learn as if and when they happen. Right. And that's when we would make the decision about should somebody continue to be around children or not. Mm-hmm. So, I think that we all agree that there are some adults, there are usually very, very few, that just shouldn't be around children. And normally, we also want to be vigilant and not rely on a five-year check to wonder if somebody is the right person to be around children. I think that's kind of an ongoing, mm-hmm. just check to feel that we're comfortable with who we're allowing to be around the children other than their teachers and support staff. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I really brought it up because that felt kind of arbitrary and almost artificial to me.
Me too.
And there were discussions about even going with further kind of checks,
right.
which again, don't necessarily give you the information that you really need.
Right.
Exactly.
I wanted to highlight, if I may, that there were several parent volunteers that were very interested and attended
right.
and contributed heavily to the discussion.
They did. Right. And like often happens with situations like this, and as Howard's alluding, so much comes down to common sense and paying attention.
Right.
You know, background checks would let us know if somebody got arrested for speeding in the state of Maine. You know,
right.
not that there's some sense of unease on the part of the child. So I think having this policy really reviewed with teachers at the start of the year, reminding them about the use of personal recording devices, et cetera, as spring gets rolling, those things are more important to me. And I feel like John is absolutely thrilled with where this landed and wants to really see it through as our key person. And I feel confident in him. So.
Mm-hmm. This just makes me think of a slightly an aside issue, but I was kind of surprised to hear that there are permanent volunteers, or however you put it, versus intermittent right. volunteers and the parents. And I've been thinking about this for a while. I'm thinking, how at some point I would love to discuss how that is possible and how it's determined who will be the permanent volunteer. And I'm speaking about it mostly as a parent who currently is volunteering. And I would have been interested in some permanent volunteer positions, and I imagine there'd be other parents too. So at some point I would really like to know more about how it all happens. How is it that besides the class field trips and helping with reading once a week or something, at some point I'd like to know more about the process of using volunteers and how people are chosen.
Mm-hmm. So I'm sorry that I have one more thing to say.
Sure.
So for item 7, with the discussion around taking and posting photographs or video. I would encourage principals, John Holdridge, whoever, to communicate this very clearly with parents and do regular reminders, because even people who seem to be very aware of this then go ahead and do it, almost not thinking. And so it needs to just, that consciousness needs to be raised among the parents that even without this policy, it's a respect issue that You may be taking a shot of your child on this field trip, but you've caught some other faces in there, and then you post it. That's just really not appropriate.
Exactly. Yeah. And we'll need to count on our principal, John, of getting the message out and originally for us. Mm-hmm. I think the quick access to personal devices has completely brought that to a place that we wouldn't have anticipated 10 years right. ago. So,
John.
So this is more of a process question, but sort of raises in my mind, once we're in the looking at tape doing background checks, are we comfortable that we know what to do if we turn up information and how we handle that? Because those are the ones that are tricky situations. Because if you're going to go look for it, you got to know what you do if you find it. And are we comfortable that we have procedures to handle that appropriately? Because those are the things that can create challenges for a school district if we're not comfortable.
I believe that we are real clear about steps to take. There aren't that many.
Okay.
And they include involving the police chief.
Yep. I it's like, once you say I'm going to look,
right.
you got to know what happened. You got to
right.
go all the way down the.
Right.
You got to be ready for what you find.
Right.
I wanted to confirm.
Right.
Yes, yes, we're ready. Should we find something we know
yep.
what to do? Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll come back with a couple answers at the second reading.
Thank you. That's good work on that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks to John on this, too.
Yes, thank you to John Holdridge. Mm. So moving on to item 6D. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the 2016-2017 co-curricular personnel nominations as outlined in our agenda.
I second.
Discussion? Again, I would like to thank these people for stepping up and working with our children, because without you, these programs wouldn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6E, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the superintendent's nominations of personnel to second year probationary contracts as outlined in our agenda.
Discussion?
I would just encourage you to read the names aloud before we vote for the public.
Kimberly, would you be willing to read the names?
Yes, I'm sorry, I didn't hear it. Karen Jennings, teacher. These are at Pond Cove School. Julie Miriam, teacher. Catherine Zellers, teacher. At the high school, Jana Duan. Sorry if I mispronounced that. Teacher.
Thank you.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6F, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the superintendent's nominations of personnel to third year probationary contracts. Pond Cove, Callie Gallant, teacher, middle school, Joshua Chase, teacher, high school, Elizabeth Murphy Lewis, social worker, Joanna Payne, teacher, Ison Simpson, teacher, Elizabeth Thomas, college counselor, and district services, Rosemary Cui, school psychologist. Cui?
Second.
Okay. Discussion?
I do have a comment, and that has to do with both these third-year probationary contracts and with the previous second-year probationary contracts, and it's probably also applies to our next motion coming up, and that is I'm curious as to the evaluation process that these teachers have gone through and what type of assurances that we know as a school board that they have met their expectations for what we have as a district for our teachers.
Do you want me to speak to that? Well, as you know, the process that's followed for teacher evaluation has changed somewhat in the last couple of years. I think it's changed for the better. And that includes for your probationary teachers. What I think is expected today is that probationary teachers, which is a which is important for their own professional growth and also for our assurance that they are teachers that we would hope will be here for the long term, are getting frequent visits from their administration, and that those classroom visits lead to candid and honest conversations about what they see. And it includes ideas and offers of suggestions for improvement and accommodations for things that seem quite impressive, and always looking for professional growth, no matter if they're beginning teachers or if they're new to Cape Elizabeth, but they may also be veterans somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And I would think that a teacher who's going from first year to second year, that assumes that they overall had a very positive experience here, and the students and parents feel the same, would know going into their second year not only what is going well, but what they need to work on to be better teachers. Everybody has a list of things to work on, and they got to be clear and not random suggestions, but specific to them as a teacher, to be clear that they're working on, with the hope that at the end of the second year, we're solid about one or the other. One is that they really ought to be brought back for a third year because we see great promise in them, or it hasn't worked out, and they aren't surprised, and they know that we've given them feedback and visited them often and had a lot of conversation, and that it just shouldn't go on. They need to find a place that's a better fit for them, mm-hmm. or maybe in some cases a different career. I think anybody going on to third year should be our belief that they have tremendous promise, and that we aren't on the fence at all. We are confident these are very strong teachers, and we want to continue to meet with them, to visit their classrooms, to give feedback, and there should be no surprises about what they need to work on and where they're headed and where they fit into the larger scheme. I have always felt that the teacher going from year three to continuing contract, we should know now that they actually are stronger than half your teachers or more, to raise the bar. Mm-hmm. So that your faculty is stronger, they have to be stronger than half your teachers, and ideally a lot stronger than half of them, to really get serious about this. I believe that teachers that are probationary too often aren't given the amount of attention that they deserve early enough. And so to me, it's those first 2 years where you really pour it on. Not that you let up in the third year, but they shouldn't be coming back for the third year and be surprised, in my opinion, unless something that happened that no one saw. So that's the kind of intensity that I think that you should be expecting from me and the principals, that there have been those visits, there have been those conversations, there has been a list of commendations, but a list of things to work on, mm-hmm. and that if everything goes well by the end of that third year, we're all confident that we've made the right decision.
I wholeheartedly agree, especially in those probationary periods where we're trying to ensure that there's a fit between the district and the teacher and the district, and vice versa. What concerns me for both E, F, and G on this agenda here is when we confirm a hire in the district, we receive as a board for our executive sessions a packet that shows the background information that assures us that the teacher has been vetted, that they met minimum requirements, and that there was a background check and what the references said, mm-hmm. all of that for when we hire. Mm-hmm. But once a teacher is in the district, I, as a board member, don't feel confident in having that same level of accountability for those reviews that are happening both in the first, second, and third probationary years and then on to continuing contracts. So this work is so important that as a board, I'm not going to not vote against these tonight because I don't think that it's a process question, and I'm sure it's not fair to the folks who are on these agendas here. But as a board member, I would feel more confident moving forward having a similar type packet as we do for first year hire, as we do for these continuing contracts. It's just a checks and balances accountability measure that I feel is missing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I appreciate that, and it's a very serious responsibility you have. I mean, I don't know one more serious than renewing contracts for your personnel to include probationary teachers. Mm-hmm. I recommended this year that we have a simple form that lists compelling reasons for extending and offering a renewal of a contract for probationary teachers. That would, in simple English, very specifically list a teacher's strengths that were unique to them, mm-hmm. as well as a short list of areas for improvement. And with two boxes, a box that says, I recommend the teacher be extended, renewed for a contract, or I recommend not. Mm-hmm. So that it's really clear where the principal stands. And that the principal signs off on that, and the teacher who's probationary signs off knowing where she stands, where he stands. And ultimately, it's my decision what to do with that as a superintendent. We don't have that whole process in place this year. We're moving in that direction. You can count on it next year. It will happen next year. There's going to be one form. It's going to be what I just said. And then I will have those. And if there are questions that you want to know about any of this, I can discuss it with you in non-public. But right now, what you mentioned about a paperwork and details, It's not today. It's not that refined. But I believe
that. Appreciate your comments on that. I mean, mm-hmm. it is an essential component of quality assurance and quality improvement going on. That unless you can document what it is that you're improving on,
yep.
which we all need to improve. But then also, we have very talented teachers throughout this district, and I'd also like to see what it is that we're celebrating in this teacher moving forward as well.
Right. That's right. We should do both. I mentioned this to a few people. I'm going to mention it to a few more. I really see a place for students and parents giving feedback to probationary teachers. I've seen this work very well in other districts. It's very useful in my experience to the teacher and to the principal to see what students are saying. And I'm talking about not just high school age students. Younger children can give a lot of feedback to their teachers as well, mm-hmm. but also parents. Questions like, you know, does a teacher seem to know are they a master of their subject? Are they challenging my child? Are they prompt in responding to questions? Are they accessible and available for additional help? I mean, there's a lot of things that it can also help. I mean, I think teachers, in my experience, have actually really wanted to hear from somebody other than a principal, how am I doing? And what's going well and where do I have room to grow? And I think that I'm going to be wondering how that might be put in place, even as a trial. And I think that it would help a teacher feel that, well, my principal is onto something, or if there's not agreement between the two of them, this can really help generate a conversation that needs to take place about what you're seeing and what I'm seeing and how is this working, so we have more assurance and with input from someone more than a single administrator.
That sounds great.
Yeah. So. Can I just add one thought too, Howard, and I'll just throw this out there. It can be really difficult having an internal calibration as an individual evaluator.
Right.
And I'm not sure practice you've had at MDI or other places before, but I have found it really useful to have one central office person. I would look at Kathy in this particular example, who might, under a Marshall Plan, conduct some of those short walk-in evals and debrief with the principal, just to get a sense if you're kind of on the same page with what you're seeing. I have found that to be incredibly useful and helpful to the prime evaluator, because that way it's, oh, well, you saw that too, or I didn't see it, well, I'll watch that next time. Mm-hmm. It'd be really useful to have another set of eyes that are there to sort of, in Joanna's words, that sort of quality control piece, so that there's a sense within the team that there's a consistent set of expectations.
And I think that Kathy and Jessica both are very willing to support in that. I think they both feel that they would not lead the evaluation, but they could be a support to the principal and the teacher, and just be another set of eyes. I agree with you.
Jess was doing that also, and for both, that would be just really helpful, I think.
John?
I was just going to add, I think these are some of the most important decisions that we make as a district.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. Continue.
And so when they come to us in the future, I would very much appreciate a summary of the steps that we've followed. And I would like the building heads to present their teachers. Come along with that, because that's where it happens. And it comes right now as a really important decision with thin information, and it puts us in a very difficult spot, and I'd like to not be there in the future. And it sounds like we're headed in the right direction in terms of the evaluation, but we need to see, and the public needs to see, this is what we did, and this is the result.
Right.
Because right now we don't see any of it.
Well, right now you do have an evaluation plan. I can't tell you what it says about probationary teachers. I know that a group of teachers who are part of the evaluation committee are meeting with Kathy, I believe, even this week, and I'm joining them for that meeting. And if it isn't clear to me how we go about evaluating teachers, or if I think there's a way to improve that, or if we as a group do, you'll see that, because ultimately, if we recommend a modification to the plan, as I understand the steps, is that we send a proposal to modify to the Department of Ed, and then they look at it against Chapter 180 and make any recommendations that they may have. And then if they're satisfied, it would come back to you for a revision for next school year. So we actually, and I think the same thing is true right now for your principal's evaluation. We have that as an approved plan that we need to follow this year. And I think it's fair to say that the administration feels that that plan, there's room for improving that plan. So the same drill, take it to the state, make some specific recommendations. So you may see something. I don't think you're gonna see something at your May meeting or your June meeting, but you may just see something, maybe June. If not, it'll be in your first of next school year. But what you're asking for is reasonable, it's appropriate, and you can count on this not being as unclear going forward.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And as we move on, and we are going to move on, I would like to just make a note that this discussion has not been about the individuals or the names on this list at all. It's been about process.
Totally.
Thanks for doing that, Elizabeth. It's very clear.
All those in favor? Thank you.
We have two votes to take, actually. That was on this.
That was a motion on just item 6F. So we're moving on to item 6G. And may I have a motion for item 6G, please?
I move to approve the superintendent's nominations of personnel to first continuing contracts. Pond Cove School, Catherine Atkinson, teacher. Danielle Hessert, teacher. Amanda Marsden, teacher. Middle school, a Terry Schmetz teacher, also Pond Cove, 0.75 FTE. High school, Nicole Carrera-Sirois, I apologize if I misspoke. Teacher, Kevin St. Jar, teacher. District services, Susan Bahadori, speech and language pathologist. Kristen Tevenian, speech and language pathologist.
Second. Welcome. Discussion?
We had it.
All those in favor? Thank you. Before we move on to item 6H, I would like to ask Catherine Messmer if this is an updated, or if this is old.
If you're looking at the agenda that says updated April 10th on the upper, on the top, those are the correct numbers.
I just wanted to make sure before we make a motion.
Yeah.
Thank you. May I have a motion, please?
Sure. I move we approve the total budget for 2017-2018 school year. Be approved and that the attested copy of said vote be filled with the meeting minutes. Do I read the voted? The paragraph here in the...
Does anybody know if we have to read that?
No, you do not, but it's best if it's in the agenda in minutes like this for the public.
As said in the agenda minutes.
Yeah.
I second.
Discussion?
Did the motion include the figures?
I think we should probably put the figures.
Do you mind just reading?
I don't mind reading at all. And that the approved budget totals $24,879,014.
Right.
Thank you.
I second.
You are more than welcome.
Discussion?
Remind me where this percent increase landed for us, Howard. Is it about 3 point?
You sent out a memo. What is the new, on this amount, what is the budget to budget and what's the tax increase?
In those packets on your desk, in front of you, there is that sheet. I printed it out for you, and if I remember correctly, the budget to budget is a 2.4 increase, and the tax increase is a 4.4 increase.
And yet to still be confirmed is our final numbers from the state. Is there another outstanding figure?
Is there not only the subsidy? And
only the subsidy.
Yeah,
and
at this point.
I see the 2.4. Yeah.
I don't see it on this one.
The paperwork that you had out in front of you is everything that's changed through the process. And I wanted to make sure you had the same paperwork that the council will be receiving the end of this week. Okay. So everybody's on the same playing field.
Yep.
4.4. Good, thank you.
These are only the items that have changed. Okay. If it's not in there, it hasn't changed, and so it'll be the same of what was originally given to you.
Right.
The five-year school budget tax and history.
This is the most important sheet. This one.
I know.
This one.
I put it in the back of the section so that they have to go through everything else to find it.
Yes.
Thank you.
So that was really a decrease in expenditures because we had made an estimate.
Yes.
And then our actual came in lower.
Yes.
For the insurance.
For the insurance, correct.
Well, I would like to say that I appreciated that in our very first rollout, we were presented a budget of under 2%. I believe it was around 1.6. Mm-hmm. And Howard and his administrative team have really done what they could, given our loss over 2 years of $1.6 million in subsidy, to come in with a pretty bare-bones budget. He then took the unusual step of allowing the administrators to present in total what they had requested, so that we could have a better sense of the kinds of student needs that had been arising in the schools and at central office and so forth, and give weight to that as well. Not many superintendents allow that, and that was a really open conversation for us. We knew that was sort of shooting for the moon, so a process step where we asked the team to go back then and really triage those requests to those they found most compelling in terms of assisting kids, I found to be done in a really practical, supportable way, so that services closest to kids, helping with struggling kids at Pond Cove in the middle school, assisting with kids with high ability through a full-time GT person, making sure our social work staff at the high school is adequate to fulfill social emotional, very critical needs at the high school. Those positions were asked to be included, which I was really happy to support. I also had appreciated Jessica coming into us with a look as a first-year special ed director at some leadership needs in the district and reallocating money to bring leadership to places in support of teachers that were budget neutral. So all along, while we knew this would have some tax impact because of our loss of state revenues, it seemed a really fine budget for us to support, a supportable one, looking at technology at the high school, all of the considerations, some of the CIP needs of the district. As a person who now can relate to lots of my Cape Elizabeth friends, who is on a retired fixed income, I feel 4.4% tax increase, while I'm not going to click heels over it, is supportable given where we want our district to continue to thrive and support kids, given what's happening on the state end. So that's the reason I support it. It's not an easy to support that additional amount in tax, but I thought a 2.44 in this budget with critical services reinstated through our administrative team was an excellent place to land.
I would also like to echo everything that Barbara said. Thank you so much. We have an amazing cadre of talented teachers and administrators in this district who have really rolled up their sleeves, especially in the face of, as Barbara said, $1.6 million in cuts over the last couple of cycles. And still we're able to deliver an incredible value for our dollar, because even with this budget, with the 4.4% increase, we are one of the lowest cost per pupil student ratios throughout our competitive market when we look at the schools that we generally compare ourselves to. And that is an incredible attribute or achievement that we have been able to consistently provide. This budget does not have a lot of meat to cut. It is to the bone. We actually have compared types of services as far as RTI and ed techs and special needs support in what we have in our district compared to what we have in those other districts that we compare ourselves to, and we're thin, and we're still thin even with this budget, but at least it's moving us in the direction that we need to go in. Delivering educational services today has never been more complex. The students' needs have never been more complex, and the way in which those services are delivered need to be creative and thoughtful, and I think we do that with this budget.
Can I add something? I just want to read it because I'll be more concise. our schools are our town's greatest asset, not only because the school employs the greatest number of people, and not only because the school buildings physically reside at the heart of our community, but because our schools have been entrusted by our community to provide the best possible education to all of our children. Our schools provide the soil from which everything grows and will grow. The school board has the great and humbling responsibility of presenting the citizens of our town with a school budget that warrants their trust. Our job is to review, question, and analyze the impact each budgetary decision has, not only for the students, but for the taxpayers. The fact that state funds for our district have been cut by nearly $1.6 million in the past 2 years is painfully evident in the modest budget expenditures brought forward by the district tonight. Nonetheless, in order to provide a strong, adaptive, progressive, and comprehensive academic environment our town has always demanded, we need to mitigate such deep cuts from the state by increasing local spending on our town's education and future. The significance of this request is not lost on anyone involved with this budget. It is not easy to keep asking for more support. However, education is a historically identified priority of this and of this town and a foundation of why Cape Elizabeth remains on the map. Everything is connected. Our future, our prosperity, our blessed community hinges on the health of our schools. And I fully support this budget and thanks all the administrators and superintendents and the fellow school board members who have worked hard in pulling it apart and supporting it.
So I fully support this budget. I'd like to thank Howard and all the administrators for their hard, detailed work. I'm delighted that we're able to come in with a budget that has only a 2.4% increase. I think it's a very responsible budget. It's actually one of the smaller expenditure increases in the last 5 years. The only one that was lower was when we actually got a tax rebate because the state number came in so late that it actually artificially depressed the number. If you look at this budget, most of our costs are labor costs. A lot of those are contracted for. So there's some small, but across the board, built-in increases in many of those contracts that in many cases are higher than the budget, overall budget rise. What that means is we've been very efficient where it's not labor costs in what we do and how we spend our money. And I really appreciate that, particularly things like what was mentioned before in terms of how we've reallocated people, how we're using our resources more thoughtfully. It's actually very impressive. And a word about headcount. We've had this discussion if people participated in the budget or watched the budget sessions. Our numbers in terms of enrollment are basically flat. They're down small numbers, but it's 1,600 kids and it's a small number. They've been basically flat for several years. They're declining small amounts, 10, 15, 20 kids. But you can't cut headcount the same way. It's not quantitative. You have all sorts of different specializations. It's not just teachers and students anymore. There's library and technology and support. It's a much more diverse group, so you can't cut headcount the same way. I do think, do those trends continue to exacerbate, we will have to revisit what we do in terms of staffing and headcount and those things. I don't think we're quite there yet, but I really appreciate the work in this budget. I fully support it. There's not fat to cut. We talked about what went back in, and it was going to have a direct impact on the quality of education that our students receive. And so thank you, and I fully support it.
I too support this budget. I think there was tremendous thought and care and attention and having the students at the forefront of each decision was right there at every step of the way. An incredible amount of effort was put into creating this budget. And I want to reiterate something that John just said, that it is a leaner budget. There is a smaller percentage increase for this budget than there has been in years past. Unfortunately, with the tax impact, it looks larger. There's a larger tax impact. And that is due to the lack of support that we've gotten from the state over the past 2 years, $1.6 million. And without that support, it unfortunately creates more of a burden on the taxpayers to provide the services that we need for the students. We don't have a revenue coming in from a large town, from a vibrant Route 1, like some other towns might have. And we intentionally have that here in Cape Elizabeth. And as a result, this is part of what happens, unfortunately, with the lack of the support of the state. I think that, again, what was put back into the budget was all services for the students, certain staffing positions to help support the teachers and ed techs and other social work positions and GT positions for gifted and talented teaching. So I am fully in support of creating a district, an educational experience for the students here that is to the standards that I think the people would like in order to create a strong educational experience for the students going through our school system.
I fully support this budget. I think it's a budget that supports the education that we want for our students in this town. I tremendously support all the time and effort that you and the administrators took, redoing numbers and going back and discussing options repeatedly. I know it was tremendously time consuming, and I really appreciate all that. Throughout the process, we kept the students as our focus when we looked at each of the items that had been pulled out of the budget. When we learned that there would likely be, we'd be likely losing $800,000 in state funding, the items that were put back into the budget will all directly impact our student population. And that was really the intent and the goal of everything that we looked at. And as everyone else has said, the increase is a modest increase. We're still not getting, I think, the recommendation for gifted and talented is two positions. We have more that we could do to improve the education here, but throughout the process, we are thinking of the students and being mindful of the tax dollars of our community. So I'm fully in support of this. Thank you.
So I, too, would like to add my voice in thanks to the hours and weeks and months of work that went into the various versions of this budget. And I know that hard conversations had to be had, and the board is confident that students were always at the center of those conversations, and we appreciate that. I would like to point out that there is a mandate from this town to provide high quality education for our students. At the same time, we hold the understanding that the state over the last two budget cycles has cut our subsidy by $1.6 million. Those two things sit together. And how do we reconcile those two facts? They're not up for debate, they're facts. It means that that burden does fall on our property taxpayers, and it's not fair. So I don't like to end a discussion with a problem, so I'll kind of start my discussion with the problem, which is I don't believe the problem resides with the school board. I don't believe the problem resides with our teachers and our administrators, nor do I believe the problem resides with our town councilors. I believe the problem is at the state level, and that although our particular state representative does everything in her power to work on this, to work on the behalf of our schools, overall, we're not feeling a lot of relief. And so that problem does need to be addressed. And so I ask the public to think about that. But I do not want to end on a negative note. What I will say is that this school district has wonderful accolades. We do wonderful things with our students. However, without the ed techs, without the GT teacher, without the behaviorists, without different specialists that have been added either at a budget neutral or at a cost, we will have students slipping through the cracks. We have students slipping through the cracks right now, and it is not because we don't have excellent teachers. It's not because we don't have people trying. We don't have the resources. We are morally and legally obligated to educate all our students, not just the ones who are self-sufficient or the high flyers or whatever you want to call them. We have an obligation to educate all of them. This budget gets closer to that. I wouldn't call it perfect, but it's an excellent step.
in the right direction. I wholeheartedly support this budget.
So I'd like to add one brief comment on the state. So if we had received roughly the average of what state support had been over the last 4 years, this would be a tax decrease budget, not a tax increase budget. Mm-hmm. Usually we receive 2.5, 2.6, you know, 1 year we got a little more million support. So this year our budget increase was about 500,000. The state aid was cut by nearly 800,000. It would have been a $300,000 tax decrease impact if the state was just average level in the last several years. So, you know, we manage our expenditures. That's what we need to do. And then, you know, how we pay for it is another question. So
I would just like to point out and sort of just say one quick thing about what you were saying about where we can look for relief in policy issues and the implication that has on the ground. As subsidies to schools are getting rolled back, it's getting more and more difficult, and those financial decisions are being pushed more and more at the local level. And it's not just the subsidy for itself, it's also the retirement. Funding for the school is also being pushed onto the taxpayers as opposed to on the state level. They're pushing that cost away. And those have long-term implications for the well-being of the people of the state of Maine. And when you look at the state health rankings that just came out last week, the state of Maine in general has been peeling back health services as well as educational services, and those are beginning to show in our rankings as a state where we're lying in comparison to the other states across the nation. We're losing ground. So it's at some point it's going to stop, and we need to pick up some ground. Thank you.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6I.
I move we approve the additional local funds for the 2017-2018 school budget in the amount of $6,856,753 to be raised and appropriated in additional local funds, and gives the following reasons for exceeding the state's essential programs and services funding model by $6,483. $6,483.184. I'm sorry, it's getting late. So says your finance chair. Please don't make me say it again.
May I have a second, please?
Yes,
I. Kathy, would you be willing just to give us the quick, short?
What this vote is about, and I'm sorry you have to vote on it, but it's state statute. This is the vote because our budget does exceed the essential programs and services funding formula by the $6.8 million that Joe has pointed out, and that's what this is saying. They want you to vote so it's clear that you understand that your budget is over and above EPS. That's basically what this is. And the reason why it's over EPS, because EPS does not support the high quality of education that we are trying to provide our kids here. So that's what this vote is about.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you. That was easy.
Thank you.
The last vote you have, I'm sorry I didn't see you earlier, but I was making sure we had the couple of our lawyer. This is, you have an option of three. The first one is a vote.
Thank you.
Requesting to keep. If we get more subsidy, to keep half of it to go to unassigned fund balance, and to have half of it go to reduce taxes. The second vote is if we get additional subsidy, have all of that go to reduce taxes. And the third item, I mean, it's a multi-choice, you can pick one. The third item is if you decide to have, if we get additional subsidy, to have it go all to the unassigned fund balance. So that's what these votes are. Last year, I believe we sent a vote saying, asking for it to go to the unassigned fund balance, but in the council's decision, they decided it to go to taxes. Mm-hmm. So.
Should we have a vote before we go to discussion?
We would need, someone would need to pick one and make a motion around it is how it would have to go.
Okay. So in looking at each of the options, I do believe we had discussed version A or something like it in one of our workshops as sort of a fair split. And of the three that are here, certainly replenishing our undesignated fund balance should be a priority. It is that fund balance that has actually cushioned this year's budget need for extra revenue by quite a bit. And we are now at an all-time low after spending an all-time high in that balance.
Are you making a motion?
So I'd like to make a motion for version A to reduce the property tax burden or having to, what we need to raise from property tax by 50% of any additional unanticipated state subsidy and use the other 50% to replenish our undesignated fund balance.
So what I'm going to do.
Second. Do you want to have a question?
Sure.
Do I remember that we are relying on $800,000 from our fund balance?
Yes, we are. Which far exceeds by twice as much the usual average. $400,000 has been our all-time high before that.
Yep. And I would see that as a key balance to to reinstate some funding if possible, as well as offer property relief. I like your motion.
It helps level out what we're asking from taxpayers in the future, which is just smart budgeting.
In years past, we have used the undesignated fund balance to cushion that tax impact to our fellow community members, and we are using an unprecedented amount this year. We can't go back and use that same amount next year. It just won't be there. So without finding a way to replenish that undesignated fund balance, we are just sort of kicking the can down the road. And while this year's taxes may be reduced a bit if our subsidy does improve, it means next year all the more volatile. I find it to be responsible and appropriate that we would share any additional subsidy with taxpayers as we are taxpayers sitting at this table. Also, I would like to note that the undesignated fund balance is not a pool of money. It's an account that it's not something that the school board can touch. It's not something that we can use for the budget. It is literally an account with a lock on it. And without prior approval from the town council, am I correct?
No.
We can't touch it.
You can touch the undesignated, it's actually the auditors changed the term. It's the unassigned fund balance
okay,
now.
Okay, unassigned fund.
You can touch that every year when you do your budget.
During budget season, but
that's
it's not
the only time.
We couldn't say, hey, we got a little more money back. We're going to hire all the.
No.
Right. We can't touch that money. Once
correct.
It goes into the unassigned fund, it really most typically is used during budget season to ameliorate a tax impact.
Exactly.
Well, I seem to recall that we've also used that fund to meet unanticipated needs. For instance, if I recall, we needed to hire one or two Pond Cove teachers when projections were way below
was contingency.
That was contingency funds.
Yep.
And then what about the years that we needed to replenish or use some funds, whether it was contingency or undesignated, when the dryer in the middle school blew up?
Boiler?
The boiler? No, there was a dryer fire too.
In any case, we used contingency for teachers.
Okay.
I wasn't here at that point, but I believe I've heard that when the boiler blew up, that you had to go to the town and ask for funds.
Okay.
Is what I've been told.
In either case, it was nice to have those so that we didn't have to figure out another way to pay for those things that weren't covered under insurance.
My point was just that this isn't extra money for us to play with, is really the point. The point is this unassigned fund balance is put aside and auditors recommend it to be at a certain level. We are barely scraping by this year, and without replenishing it to some point, we won't have it available to us next year to mitigate that tax impact. So that's all I was going to say.
Question? If we were looking at our budget, in the abstract, where would we want our undesignated funds balance to be about, and where is it now?
I mean, there is state statute that our unassigned fund balance should not be more than 3% of our budget. So currently, it would be about 700,000 max, because if you keep the fund balance higher than that, the state technically can take it away from you. Mm-hmm. So,
but then there's a recommendation for it to be around what is it, 1 to 2?
There is that on the school side, there is no recommendation on how much you can keep. There are some municipal school districts that use all of their unassigned fund balance every year, because that money is set aside specifically for the school department. If something happens and they need additional funds, they go to the town council and request monies. So there is no, the town council is, the town is required to keep a certain minimum, but the school department is not.
So do we have a sense of where we would like it to be and where it's at? It's currently at like, it's 3? Where's it at now?
The audited amount was, I believe, as of June 30th, was I think 1.3 million.
No, where will we be forecast in this budget for us?
What I anticipated is at the end of this year, if we were using the 800,000, we will get at least 200,000 to go in back into the unassigned fund just because of unanticipated revenues and us not spending our budget down all the way. So it's at least 200,000. Howard and I were talking about it earlier today, and I'm fairly comfortable that we'll probably get another 500,000 back into the budget, back into the unassigned fund balance. So that would probably put up the balance to be about 700,000 as of next June 30th.
Where is that coming back in from?
How you get the money into the unassigned fund balance at the end of the year, the auditor takes what we haven't spent.
Okay, got it.
And what additional revenue came in.
Got it.
And all that money goes into the unassigned fund balance.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Further comment? The motion on the table is for version A, and it is agenda item 6J. We will have that all together in the minutes. All those, further discussion?
No, I was going to say, based on what Catherine said, I would suggest we consider amending the version on the table to match version B to return to taxpayers, actually, because it sounds like we'll actually have a decent number in there.
I think what we would want to do is vote on the motion, okay, and if it depends, passage and failure, there can be another motion.
How does that?
I thought we had to vote on one of the options.
We have to finish this one first.
No.
Basically, we're just finished.
So I proposed the motion for version A.
And I just proposed amending it, potentially amending it to C.
That's not
a wording in C.
You can make an amendment, and the person who proposed the motion can either accept or
B. I decline that motion.
Okay. B. Sorry, to B, I'm sorry.
So Joe has declined your amendment.
Okay.
Would you like us to vote on your amendment to...
It can't, it has to have a second first. It has not received a second.
Your amendment.
To amend it.
Right, and you need to have a second. Thank you.
If it's accepted without... Accepted, I don't need a second.
Right.
If it's not accepted, I would need a second before a vote.
Correct. Do we have a second? Seeing none. Now we...
So would the amendment dies and you're back to the original motion.
Okay, I believe that's correct. So, all those in favor of the original motion? And all those opposed? Okay, thank you. We just went through a little parliamentary procedure exercise.
Not bad for 9 o'clock at night.
I know,
you guys are doing great.
Tried to keep it to 8:30. Come on. Item.
Thank you, Catherine.
I know, thank you. Item 7, committee reports. Crisp reports would be appreciated at this hour.
I report that we just voted to accept the budget from the finance chair.
Buildings and grounds is continuing to build steam and have some really great conversations with committees and schools. And we are collecting input through the principals of the teachers within the school about what are the needs in the facilities. And we haven't completely finalized that list, but our models are very dropping together the options and the things that are on the table, and we just kind of the discussion is not completed. However, I think we have played with the idea of using for other needs as opposed to the general grant that doesn't exist for me. We have an additional budget. It's been putting that much money towards what we've never been have, and using money towards things that we know that are existing and TLC. So,
thank you. We've heard from policy. Wellness.
Wellness has been doing a great job as well. We're a pretty dedicated group at 7:30 on Wednesday mornings, every Wednesday. I dare say the coffee and meals, but making a lot of our progress. We're very close to completing the wellness policy, which is actually quite complicated, with lots of areas. Physical activity, emotional well-being, nutrition, that was the other word I was thinking of. It's been really exciting. Lots and lots of really thoughtful discussion about kind of culture and intentional way of embracing wellness.
Heavy stuff and important. Thank you for that work.
Yeah,
just hang on.
The town comp comprehensive committee is meeting tomorrow night at 7 in the Georgia conference room. And tomorrow night, the committee members will discuss, share with the group what they hope to bring to the committee in the direction of the plan. As always, public is always welcome at these meetings, and I would like to just add now for an agenda request that at our next meeting that the school board have a discussion about what we hope to voice is our wishes for the comp plan moving forward. So I'd like to request that for our agenda next time.
So further committee reports? Moving on to agenda requests. Susanna started us off. Thank you for that. So board members should be thinking about town comprehensive plan input from the school board. And if there aren't any other agenda requests at this time, the public should know that agenda requests may be made through the superintendent's office via email, smoke signal, telephone call. Item 9, announcements of upcoming meetings.
So I just want to say the school board budget, there's a three-step process with the town council. The first step is our workshop, which is Tuesday, I think that's downstairs in this building, where we present the budget and walk the town council through it. The next step in that project, the second step of the town council, is their public hearing on Monday, May 8th in these chambers. I believe that starts at 7. I'm so sorry, I have no idea where that place comes from. It's a sign that we need to go. And town council votes on the school board budget on Monday, May 15th. And of course, the final step in the school board budget process is the exciting referendum budget for where the citizen vote on June 13th. Vote early, vote early.
If I may just follow up on that. Oh, Susan.
Oh, maybe you can say it.
Well, I was going to say that the hearing date on May 8th is a time for public to give input on the budget to town council, and I believe that that town council also does take public input on May 15th when they vote, but frequently, as do we, it's nice to hear questions, comments, and input before you vote. So that's why they set a hearing date. It's when they put it out to the public to hear comments, and so we encourage the public to come and give their comments.
I was just going to add that last night at the town council, they requested that the workshop on the 25th of April be videotaped, which is great news and has not been the protocol in the past.
And has been a concern.
And has been a concern. Right.
Policy upcoming?
Policy will be meeting again on Tuesday, May 2nd at 6:30. First Tuesday of the month, we'll get a couple quick answers on the volunteer policy. Kathy's going to finish walking us through graduation requirements, and hopefully we'll start hearing some wellness feedback. Not too. Okay, thanks.
Next wellness committee is tomorrow morning at 7:30. On Cove and Heather Gambazer, that's the library there on Cove. And the next building and grounds meeting is Wednesday, May 3rd.
Thank you. Item 10, may I have a motion, please?
I move we adjourn.
Someone yelled second from out there.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you.